brings a rhema word, Lord God. Father, we ask that you begin to cover Minister Corey's body right now. Father God, we rebuke the enemy from any distraction that may come about in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that you are filling him with your precious blood. You are filling him with an anointing, Lord God. Father, we thank you, Lord, as we come expecting a word, Lord God. We come expecting miracles. We become expecting signs and wonders, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your power, Lord God. Thank you for your grace, Lord God. Father, we are praying right now for every man, every African-American man and woman, Lord God. Father, we are asking, Father, that you begin to cover these men with your precious blood, Lord God. Cover our law enforcement, Lord God. Raise up a standard in our law enforcement, Lord God. Raise up a standard, Lord God. Father, we rebuke racism, Lord God. We rebuke injustices, Lord God. We rebuke what's going on in our nation that is negative, Lord Jesus. And raise up mighty men and women of valor, Lord God. We thank you for it right now. We praise you for it right now, Jesus. And as we pray for our African American men and women, Lord God, we are praying for every man and every woman, every boy, every girl of every race, in the mighty name of Jesus. And we say, have your way in their lives right now. Have your way in their lives right now, Jesus. Do things, Lord God. Do a new thing in their life right now, in the name of Jesus. Father God, we put the state of Alabama at the altar, Lord God. We put the state of Georgia at the altar, Lord God. We put the state of New York at the altar, Lord God. We put every single state that is going through these things, Lord God, that is going through these protests, Lord God, that is going through these things. Father God, we put them on the altar. And Lord God, we thank you for the Prince of Peace. We thank you for the Prince of Peace right now to start shifting things for his glory. Start to shift things for your glory, Lord God. Disturb the soil, Lord God. Disturb the earth, Lord God. We don't understand what's going on, Father, but we know that there's a special rhema that's coming, Lord God. There's a special anointing, Father, and we accept it, Lord God. Thank you for choosing us for such a time as this, Father. Lord God, we will forever be grateful. We will forever be grateful and be humble, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for every family. We thank you for every husband. We thank you for every wife, Lord God. We thank you for every child, in the mighty name of Jesus, as their home, Father. Sit with them in their home, Lord God. Sit with them, Lord God. Begin to speak to their hearts, Father. Begin to speak to their hearts, Father. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, give them confidence like never before in your word, Lord God. Father, give us we yearn to chase after you, Lord God. We yearn to chase after you and not at man, Father. We yearn to chase after the anointing and not the position, Father. We yearn to chase after the anointing and not the promotion. In the name of Jesus, we yearn to chase after the anointing, Father, and not the placement. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we yearn to chase after you and have a heart after your own son, Father. Father, give us the guidance. Continue to guide and direct our path in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we ask that every request that is made known right now, in the name of Jesus, every request that is not made known in your son's name, you begin to go into action right now, Father. And the angels are going into action, Father, and they are receiving the command and the commission from you, Lord. And then you are answering these prayers, Father. Every circumstance, every question, Lord, every scenario, Father. Lord, we ask that you have your way. You have your way in it right now, in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you for this service right now. We thank you for this situation, Father. We thank you for the isolation. So, God, we understand that we're isolated. But while we're isolated, Father God, we are insulated in your spirit. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for the isolation, Father, because we are insulated in your love, insulated in your spirit, insulated in your relationship. So continue to speak to us. Continue to give us that power, Lord God. Continue to give us that anointing, Father. Continue, Lord God, as we spread our arms and our hands, Lord, and as we lay prostrate before you, and as we give you reverence, Lord God, continue to bless our families. Continue to bless our situation. And we thank you for it right now. We praise you for it right now. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And God's people say, amen, amen, amen,
amen, amen, amen,
amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Good morning, good morning, Bridge Church.
Good morning, good
we would
morning,
like to thank everyone for tuning in near and far, and we hope that you're pleased and blessed with our praise.
Hallelujah.
Come on and clap your hands wherever you are and give God some praise. How many know that hallelujah is the highest praise?
Hallelujah, yeah, hallelujah.
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 Lord God, because you reign. You reign over any circumstance that we face, Lord God. No matter what's going on in this world, Lord God, we know that you have the power to rule over it all, Father God. We thank you for it. Because my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
Yes, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns, Lord, you reign above every name.
With power
and majesty,
dominion,
authority, you reign.
With power and majesty,
with power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
God reigns.
Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
Yes, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
With power
and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Oh, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
Yes, my God.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
With power and majesty,
dominion,
There's only one name. There is only one name with power to save. With power to save.
There is only one name.
There is only one name. There is only one name. Power to save. With power to save. Our God is champion. He reigns forevermore, forevermore.
Sing
our God is champion. He reigns
forevermore,
forevermore. Forevermore.
God, our God is champion.
He reigns,
he reigns
forevermore,
forevermore.
Declare that you reign, oh God. You are King of Kings. You are Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. We thank you, oh God, for sending your Son Jesus, that he would die for our sins, oh God, and that he would wash them, oh God. He would wash us clean, oh God, and make us white as snow, oh God. We thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus that was shed for us on Calvary, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for sending your only begotten Son, that we may be bought back, Lord God, with the price of his precious blood, oh God. Oh, we thank you, Father. We honor you this morning. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Helping facilitate our communion this morning. And so on this morning, we'll be using these communion elements here. However, if you are joining us online, and if you don't have one of these, please feel free to substitute the juice and crackers with whatever you have. The last time I took communion at home, my bread was a slice of pineapple, and the blood was a chunk of watermelon. And it may sound like I'm trying to be a little funny, but it was a holy moment because of what communion is. It doesn't matter as much as what you take, as long as you take it in remembrance. And so I want you to go ahead, if you're at home online and you usually would just sit through this part, go ahead and find something. Get some water, get a cracker, get some juice, get something. Get a piece of ice out the freezer. And when you do that, as you do that, what I'm going to do is give you a heads up of what we'll be doing once we get started reading with the scripture. We want you to know that communion is a ceremonial meal or a sacrament in which we partake in together as believers in remembrance of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, his completed work on the cross that atones for our sins and heals us. Okay, when Jesus died on the cross and when he rose again, salvation and healing there. So what we do is we partake in these sacraments here too, in remembrance of what Jesus Christ did. And so we're going to go to the scriptures this morning. And Mark chapter 14, verse 22 through 26. All right, so go ahead and get there. If you have your Bible, if you have a phone, or if you just like to follow along on screen, we're going to Mark chapter 14, verses 22 through 26 in the NLT version, please. The word says that as they were eating a Passover meal right before the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And Jesus took some bread and he blessed it. And so together, let's take our bread. And we're going to pray. All right, we're going to ask the Lord to bless this. And so please assume your posture of prayer. Just Father God, as we come to you today, as we acknowledge you and remember you, Lord, we just thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to this earth. And Jesus Christ, we thank you for walking perfectly and living your life as a man, perfect, sinless, blameless, however, allowing yourself to be sacrificed, crucified on the cross on the behalf of our sins. And Lord, as we take this communion, we bring our full selves before you. We humble ourselves. We repent. Your word says that we should come into communion cleansed and forgiven. Because of what you did, Lord, we have opportunity for that forgiveness today. And so, Lord, we receive your forgiveness, Jesus Christ. Every sin that is coming to our minds, every unconscious sin, we turn and repent. We look to your face, God, and we recognize any way that's in us that's not like you, Lord. We change our mind about it right now. We change our hearts, Lord God, and receive your forgiveness, Lord. We pray that you look at us through the blood of Jesus Christ and see us as holy. And as we do, as Jesus Christ, Lord, as we go back to the scriptures, he took the bread and he broke it in pieces. And he gave it to the disciples saying, take it, for this is my body. So go ahead and break whatever you have and take it in its entirety. The scriptures go on to say, and then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and they drank from it. And he said to them, this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice for many. Let's take it and drink it. Jesus went on to say that, and he told them that I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new in the kingdom of God. And then the word says that they sang a hymn and went to the Mount of Olives. And so let's join together in song to celebrate and commemorate the sacrifice of Jesus Christ.
You are the reason. Good morning, good morning, good morning, Bridge Church family. Good morning and welcome, welcome, welcome. We just want to say and welcome to anyone out there that's joining us for the first time. Welcome to our live stream. We just want to say we hope that you are here and that you get something out of what you hear today. We know that you're divinely appointed to be here because you could have joined in on any other stream, but God directed you here. So we thank God that you'll be blessed and get a word today. Amen. 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 Amen.
Good morning, good morning, Bridge Church of Alabama. How we doing this morning? Let's give God a praise. We are in the house of the Lord. And if you have come with an expectancy, let me hear somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you come with an expectancy, let me hear you shout hallelujah one more time.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes, yes. Amen, amen. Well, I'm Minister Desmond Peacock, and I have been given the humble opportunity to give you all the offertory increase message this morning, and we're going to get right to the word, okay? We're going to go to Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 through 9. I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation as well as the Message Bible as well, okay? But you can read it in whatever version Bible you have at home. And it reads, "Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit." So let's not be tired of doing what is good. And at just the right time, we will reap a harvest. Harvest of blessings if we don't give up. Now we're going to read that in the Message Bible because I like how the Message Bible breaks it down. And it says on Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 through 9, it says, "Don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God. What a person plants, he will harvest. The person who plants selfishness, ignore the needs of others, ignoring God, harvest a crop of weeds. All he'll have to show for his life is weeds. But the one who plants in response to God, letting God's Spirit do the growth work in him, harvest a crop of real life, eternal life." So let's not allow ourselves to get fatigued doing good. At the right time, we will harvest a good crop if we don't give up or quit. Amen. In our giving today, I would like to encourage you all that are sitting out there in Facebook Live land in your homes, comfortable. I would like to encourage someone and tell you all, I want to ask a question. How many of you are ready to trust God just enough not to give up? How many of you grow weary or get agitated or in some cases kind of allow your friends and coworkers to detour you from the will of God? Let's be honest. How many of us actually get in those predicaments where we actually start getting ourselves into think traps? And sometimes we kind of second guess giving, and in this case, kind of giving our tithes and offering to God because of what we're going on in our own life. Especially what's going on today in today's society and our nation. You know, I hear myself and I hear some friends of mine, we talk about it, we vent, and we sit there and be like, man, I'm tithing, you know, I know I got to pay these tithes and these offerings, but we in a pandemic. I need this money. I need this money for supplies. You know, I'm at home. I'm not doing as much as I used to do. So God, you know my heart. You know I need this money. Or, for example, I have kids. You know, my kids are out of school, and all they're doing is eating up every single thing in the house. And I need this money, God. But there were also times where, due to my situation, I'm just being transparent, or season that I was in, I allowed my friends to the left or to the right of me, I allowed them to make a mockery of my faith strictly because of my status at the time. So, for example, instead of me thinking about it, I had my friends say, "You still tithe into the Bridge Church of Alabama? Don't they know you need that money? Don't they know where we're at right now, the crisis we're in, that what's going on day in, day out? We don't know if we're coming or we're going, but they still want you to give to that church. You need those supplies." Or guess what? You haven't been working. You know, you got family and friends that's collecting unemployment, and the Bridge Church of Alabama wants you to give them your money. Well, let me tell you something. In that instance, when I was hearing those things, and I was even thinking about, I believe that it was a trick of the enemy at the same token, because then I had to stop and I had to realize the God that I serve. I had to stop and I had to realize the God that I serve. The one who gave his only son, his only begotten son, just to die for me. He gave his only begotten son just to die for me. The one who paid the ultimate sacrifice, because guess what? He saw my future. He saw my future before I was even born and wanted to save me from myself. His son was whipped, beaten, abused, nails punctured through his hands and feet, and he was crucified on a rugged cross just for me. And guess what? Not only did he do all that stuff for me, he did it for you. He did it for you. And what I love about it is, when he was going through all of this, he never got weary. He never gave up. He never said, "You know what? I'm the son of God. Why am I going through this? I can just go back to heaven and chill with my father." No, he had an assignment, and he never grew weary. He loved you enough not to give up. So I encourage every single one of you to trust God just enough not to give up. And guess what the benefit is in trusting God just enough not to give up? Harvest. That's the benefit. So what is harvest exactly? So I broke down the letters of harvest in my own meaning, and I hope this will touch you at home. H, healing. Healing to your body, healing to your situation. A, an accumulation of wealth. An accumulation of wealth to your finances. An accumulation of wealth in your household. R, reconciliation of relationships and marriages. A reconciliation. V, victory over your circumstances. Victory over every single circumstance. E, extraordinary favor. Extraordinary favor. Favor ain't fair, but guess what? It sure feels good. S, success in school. Success in your job. Success in your method of employment. And guess what? Success in your privately owned businesses. Success. And T, total power. Total power over the enemy. Total power over the enemy. That's your harvest. So I say again, how many of you are ready to trust God just enough not to give up? Prepare your giving.
So you can use me. I give myself away.
Thank you for partnering with us to advance the kingdom of God. We have our ways to give. You can text your donation amount to 84321, or you can visit us online at bridgechurchofal.com and go to our donation page. You all have your donation amount, your tithing, your offering, your seed. We would like to hold them up to God right now. So if you're sitting where you are and you've given online, guess what? That seed has already been planted. So raise your hand to God right now as we bless these seeds. Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you again for another opportunity that we have been granted to give ourselves to you. Father, we pray that every seed that has been planted right now, every donation, every tithing, every offering, Father, it has been planted because we are ready for a harvest, Lord God. Father, in spite of what we may be going through right now, in spite of what we may be going through or what we may have gone through last week, in spite of what we may be going through in the weeks to come, Father, we believe that if we trust you not enough, if we trust you more than enough, but some of us are on the us are just giving up, but we, Lord God, that we trust you just enough not to give up on our certain and continual circumstance and our present circumstance right now. We believe that you will provide a harvest. We believe that you will start to shake things and shift things for your glory and bless us like never before. So we thank you for it now. We praise you for it right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So you myself away. Hey, hey, hey. I give myself away so you can
take my heart. All my dreams,
all my
Well, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Good morning, Bridge Church family of Alabama and all of our friends and family across the land. God bless you. For those of you who don't know me, I am Pastor T. I'm the senior pastor here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, the greatest church in the world. Amen. 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 Well, praise the Lord. Look, it is such a blessing to be here. It's a blessing, and I'm sure you would agree, just to be alive today. And to be in the right standing with God, huh? Amen. It's one thing to live, and it's one thing to live in Jesus. Amen. And so we're living in Jesus today. Jesus said, he said, I come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. Well, we're enjoying the abundance of life today through Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. Look, I'm not going to be the one ministering today. I wanted to take an opportunity to just give a few announcements before we go forth, but one of my spiritual sons will be ministering today. You all may be familiar with him. Amen. Amen. Yes, yes. As a matter of fact, he started his phase one, his first ministry preached on last Sunday. He's been teaching Bible study, but he preached something on last Sunday. Amen. It stirred us up. And so he's coming back again today, but I wanted to announce this. Here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, we believe that the Lord is the one who, the Bible says this, he promotes and he demotes. He exalts and he takes down. The Lord, his power, he has the authority to do that. And it is my responsibility to see that as God continues to lift and exalt those that are in ministry. And so next week, I want you all to tune in. Next week, I have scheduled that I am going to ordain our first deacon here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, and then we're going to be licensing our ministers. And let me say this. Our ministers, and I'll give you their names in a moment, but let me tell you this. We started an excessive and very deep training for the ministry and for the deacon license and ordination. We started, the first phase started October the 4th, 2019. We met every Friday evening and we taught for 2 hours and we went into depth to teaching. That phase one, I call that phase one, and phase one ended December the 3rd of 2019. These ministers and Deacon Corbett, we went in and we began to teach and we began to learn the principalities and the principles and the ordinances of what the church meant and how it got started. And I mean, we went into detail and what Christ's intent is for the church, not just then, but what his intent is today. And so that was phase one. And then phase two, we picked back up with phase two March the 21st. And that was every Saturday morning we began to teach. And we went in depth in terms of responsibility and things of that nature in terms of what it is to be a minister in God's church and the responsibility of it and what is God looking for. And phase two began March the 21st. And we concluded on yesterday, June the 6th. So if you look at those dates, you can tell that we really had some in-depth teaching. It was really good. I believe that the ministers and Deacon Corbett walked away. Praise God. They walked away with some good teaching that that really, I believe, God orchestrated the topics of this, topics of training. And so with that being said, I'm going to be licensing minister and our first lady. I'll give her name first. Our first lady, Latrella Nolan, will be licensed next week. Let me give you the date. So next week on Sunday, our Sunday service will include our licensing and ordination for Deacon Corbett. So next week, tune in during our Sunday service. We're going to be licensing our ministers. We have a total of four ministers. That is our First Lady, Minister Latrella Nolan. She'll be being licensed. And then we'll have Minister I'm always calling him my spiritual son. I forget his name sometimes because I say son so much. But Desmond Peacock, he was just here giving the offertory message. He'll be receiving his license. We'll be giving a license to, not be giving, they have earned, Corey Dixon. You'll be hearing from him. He'll be receiving his license. And then we have Minister Johnsy Pinnegar. She's coming now. Let me tell you something about Minister Pinnegar. She has been a licensed minister for some years now. But she wanted to come back in. See, this is the thing about God. God will, see, when you allow God to do a work in you, you can humble yourself before him. And he said, if you humble yourself before him, he will exalt you. Well, she came back in, even though she's licensed and been in the ministry for years now, years. She's come in, and she came, and she took part in the training. She was here on every Friday night. She was here on the Saturdays and took part of the training. She said, you know, Pastor, she said, even though I've got my license before, she said, but what you're teaching, some of this stuff I've never been trained or taught before. And she said, and some of the things I have been taught on, she said, but I don't think there's nothing wrong with me coming back and making sure, you know, that God is still pouring into me and that I'm still vital and alive and ready to go forth and do the will of the Lord. And so she's come back. She's one of our elder ministers, and she's going to be licensed. So I'll have an opportunity to relicense her again. Praise God, relicense her. And then we have our very first deacon of the church, Carlos Corbett. He's going to be ordained as a deacon. And I will tell you this, and I'll tell you more during the ceremony, but these people, these ministers of the Lord, they have committed their lives to Christ. Their life has been an example for those to follow. And God, I know within my heart that God is pleased with the service that they have rendered unto his people. And I'll do more because I'll be ministering that Sunday. I'll be ministering next Sunday, and I'll be ministering in reference to who God appoints. I'll give you the rest of it on Sunday. I can't give you because I start preaching it. See, so I ain't gonna give it to you today. But look, just know that it's gonna be a good word next Sunday. I want you all to join in next Sunday as we just honor these men and women of God that have given their life towards God's ministry. And I just really believe that this is just a beginning of what God has in store for his people. I also wanted to mention our very own Corey Dixon, who will be ministering in a few minutes here. He's leaving. Him and his wife will be traveling and transitioning to another place, another region in the United States. I'm not going to say where it is because you may try to follow him and I don't want, he might not want no, what do you call them folks that be following with the cameras and everything? Yeah, paparazzi. So I'm not going to tell you where he's going, but he's transitioning to another place in the country, and him and his wife will be traveling next month in July. And so we're giving him a farewell on June the 28th. And with that farewell, we're also going to be celebrating our ministers that's going to be getting licensed as well. So our minister and our deacon. So we want you to just be a part of that celebration. That's June the 28th. We'll be a part of that. You'll be a part of that celebration. We won't be going live for the celebration, the actual, you know, party and everything. We won't go live for that. But we'll have some clips and some pictures out there for you. So didn't want to keep you very long. Wanted to give you an opportunity to know what's going on next week. Want you all to tune in because we're still operating in the social distancing. We're not going to have we're not going to have people here inside the building, but we will be opening up so that you all can see as we do a virtual celebration and ordination and license for those ministers. God bless you. Like I said, I'm not mentioned today. As you can see, I'm full. I could bring a word, but I got a chance to talk with Minister Corey, and I'm just excited about the word that he's going to bring. I believe the Lord has really planted something in his heart today that's going to really be relevant to what's going on in your life. And so without further ado, I'm going to bring up our Minister Corey Corbin. If you will, just point your hands at the camera. Say, bless the Lord. God bless him. God bless his mouth. Bless his tongue. Bless everything that's within him. Bless him in Jesus' name. God bless you all. I'll talk with you later. Corey Dixon, not Corbett, Corey Dixon. Oh, y'all got these C's in your name. Corey Dixon. Amen.
Oh, no, but thank you for the intro and bringing me in like that. My name is Corey E. Dixon. So praise God. And I just want to welcome everybody again. I know you've already been welcomed, but I just want to take the opportunity to look into the camera and just say welcome again. Thank you for tuning in and staying locked in. I do believe that today is a special day. I really do. And I'm not saying tomorrow not going to be better. Or yesterday wasn't good either. But today I believe is a special day. I've been invigorated by everything I've heard and experienced this morning from coming in, seeing the diligence, the holy busyness of preparing for this. And God gave me a bit of a visual, and not a vision, but just a visual of when I came in, that when I was sitting back there, and by the time Minister Desmond got up here to give his message, I could just see in my mind, it's like a track, like a 4x4, like a 4x4, a track race, right? And I could just see our media team back there in the booth with the first leg sprinting out, right? Just getting everything set up. Pass the baton to the worship team. They come up here and allow God to use them, you know, and then they pass the baton to Minister Desmond. He's running. Now I feel like I'm just, boom, now it's my turn, all right? So I'm about to try to go ahead and run my race, okay? Go ahead and run my leg, you know? So that's the vision that God gave me. So just know that you are in a moment right now. If you're tuned in, if you're in the building, you already know that. But if you're logged in, just stay tight, because I think that the blessings are still being poured out right now. So I always want to just take a moment to just honor the pastor and first lady of the church for giving me the opportunity to come up and speak. It is a great opportunity to be able to do this on live. What I say is live. There's no going back. They might have about 10 seconds to try to get to that camera, but they trust me. They trust me, and that's what's up, you know. So I appreciate that opportunity to be able to do this. And I always want to recognize my wife. Specifically this morning, we had a 10 a.m. service. We had a 10 a.m. service outside. Since I've been here, I've been taught repeatedly, church starts at home. You know, your home, your family is your first ministry. And so I had the opportunity to have a ministry moment with my wife this morning. So I definitely appreciate you for that. And so when Minister Desmond was up here, he read a scripture. And this was not on my docket per se, but in Galatians 6 and verse 7, it says, "Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God." And that just... it burned on my heart. I've already been on that. I've been on justice. I've been on it because of everything that's going on right now in our country and our nation. Justice has just been burning through social media, through our minds and in our hearts. We see it. And so today, the title of my message is No Justice, No Peace. And I say that boldly, and I understand that term and that phrase may feel very loaded at this time. They say, no justice, no peace, man. Come on, man. This is church, man. Like, I ain't come here for all that. Right. Some of you may be like, man, I've been waiting to hear this from the church. You know, I've been wanting that. So whatever side you're sitting on, I would ask you to stay put. I think you will enjoy this message, but as justice has been such a relevant topic, I want to just give a quick demonstration of what justice is. As we look at a progression of justice, especially in the idea of a social justice, we want to look at it as a spectrum. Social justice is just not something that gets flicked on and off, okay? One of the first steps to social justice is diversity and inclusion. And so one of my advisors uses this analogy often. So think of it like a party. Diversity and inclusion is the dominant culture saying, you know what? We think that other people should be here. There should be different representations of other people in the room, okay? So that's diversity and inclusion. They're around and they're somewhat included, but they're not really all the way in, okay? The next step on our way to social justice is equality. And so we hear a lot about equality. We want equality. And so equality means that they're in the party and they should be able to have the same, they should be able to be in the same party we're in. You know, if I got a cup of juice, you get a cup of juice. I get a slice of cake, you get a slice of cake. We all in a party.
Right.
All right? And so you're in here, you're kind of getting what we're getting, but you're not quite mixing in. The next step is equity. Now, what equity means is that we're accommodating people based on their specific need. And so let's say, hey, I've been at the party all day, you know, and then I'm here with a young child, and they're past time for food. We're ready to eat. It would be equality to give me and the child the same portion. However, based on my size and their size, equity means I get what is appropriate for me and you get what is appropriate for you. Just based on the circumstances. That's equity. Social justice is the last step. Social justice is where we're saying, not only do you need what accommodates your context, but I'm willing to give up some of the benefit I've had for you not having it so that you may have it. And I know that might have sounded confusing. I'm gonna take a few steps back. Social justice is, hey, I recognize it's been a certain amount of time you haven't had something that I've had the whole time. So rather than me just saying, yeah, you should be here, and me feeling bad for you, sympathizing with you, potentially even empathizing with you, I'm going to say, I'm going to meet you halfway. I'm going to give you some of the privilege that I've had to make your experience more similar to mine. And that's justice. And so when you read a verse that says, don't be misled, you cannot mock the justice of God, that's a pretty serious thing. Because God's justice is a little more serious than even ours. But let's continue. I want to go to Romans 5, Romans chapter 5, verse 1. And we're going to go to the NLT version. We'll go to the NLT version. In light of what we just talked about, and you look around the nation, I think it's easy to understand that if a person has been withheld from, mistreated, or oppressed for so long, how they might have the understanding that if there is no justice, then there will be no peace. And when you hear that phrase, that might make you feel very differently based on where you are situated in society. And so if you are somebody who's been oppressed, who's been unheard, who's been unseen, no justice, no peace may motivate you. If you are someone who has reaped the benefits of privilege over the course of time, whether you're willing to recognize it or not, no justice, no peace may be intimidating to you. But I want to level the playing field a little bit really quick as we read this scripture that we have. It says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so who is we? Black folks? White folks? Rich? Poor? We is anyone who's been justified by faith. And the peace we get is with God. Through Jesus Christ. And so if we can receive this scripture, it helps level the playing field some. Because despite what's going on in society, in Christ, we all have the same opportunity to be justified. Amen. Through Christ. Amen. Which gives us peace with God. So therefore, again, we can say if there's no justice, if there's no justified, if we're not justified in Christ, then there'll be no peace. And when I say justified with Christ, that means, okay. Calm down for a second, y'all. How long has it been? It's been about 6 minutes. All right, now. All right, now. So here's the deal. Because of our sinful state, as the human race, our human race, we deserve death. The wages of sin is death. That's in the scripture. Christ died on our behalf. Therefore, he fulfilled justice, because the death that we are supposed to experience, he experienced it for us. And if you remember the conversation we had at the beginning, is somebody willing to give up their privilege for somebody who has not had a certain privilege? Christ had every privilege. Brother Desmond said it. He came from heaven. He was in heaven and came to earth to live a life like us so that we may be saved through him. So that levels the playing field. But at the same time, we cannot discredit, minimize, or discount the experiences of people here on earth. Okay? So again, I say, no justice, no peace. I want to tell a quick story. This earlier this January, on Martin Luther King Day, it fell on the 16th, 15th this year. Martin Luther King Day. I'm gonna just set the scene a little bit. I was in the middle of a long-term fast. I started on the first of the year. So I was on day 15 or 16, whatever day MLK was on. At 6 a.m. in the morning, I was at a prayer service at a local church, getting filled up. I'm feeling great. I'm feeling pretty good. It's MLK Day, and I was heading into the office to get caught up on my work. In the prayer service, we started praying for the authorities in our nation. And the pastor who was leading this prayer service was encouraging us to pray for the police. And I'm going to be honest with y'all. I got a little attitude about it. I'm sitting here like, man, with all this stuff going on, we praying for the police. And in this context, it was a majority white context. And just as a black man, I got a little offended. Right. Holy Spirit's like, started knocking on me. And I was prompted very strongly to pray on the behalf of the local police force in the area. Right. And once I did, my heart softened up and I recognized, that's what I should do. And I felt peace from it. In my prayer, I was just like, God, I pray that the police officers today are righteous, they're just, and they don't kill nobody. That was my prayer. Not the highest standard, but just don't kill nobody today. That was my prayer. And so I leave immediately after. I was heading to the office, and now it's about 7 a.m. in the morning. I'm coming up by my office on campus, and I see a police car in the driveway of my building, and I knew I had to pass it to turn it to my parking lot, right? And as I'm passing it, I'm thinking like, not this morning. You know what I'm saying? But I just keep driving. I get a little tense. Black men, I got a little tense as I was driving past police officer. But before I could even get all the way past the car, they went ahead and pulled out behind me. Now, we were the only two out there at the time, only two cars. It was pretty early in the morning. And so he pulled out right behind me. I'm like, coincidence, please. Red and blue lights on, just like that. Okay, I pull off to the side, and I'm sitting here. I just pray for these folks.
Right. Come on.
And I didn't even want to pray for these folks. And then I'm going to pray for these folks, and then now look.
Come on.
You know, here we go. So I pull off to the side. They pull in behind me, block my car in, you know. He gets out. And as long story short, I had my license was out of date. However, it wasn't. So there was a bit of confusion there. The officer was not the meanest person in the world, but he was not the nicest person in the world. I kind of walked up to the door, snatched the door open, you know, and I'm just trying to be peaceful and calm. It was freezing cold that morning, and I was frustrated. As soon as I get into the parking space, first thing I do is I text a couple of my brothers, I text my wife, I text my mom, pray for your boy, please. It's cold out here. I ain't even do nothing. I don't know what's happening. I'm just letting y'all know. Intercession, please. You know, and so I'm going through that process. It's MLK Day. I'm frustrated and I'm mad. And I'm like, why is this happening to me? I didn't even get a ticket. I did nothing wrong. So why am I getting pulled over? Is it because of my car? Not the nicest car. I'll be honest with y'all. It's not a car that represents privilege. It's not my truck. Amen. I was going to not say truck today. They made me do it. Y'all can't see them, but they made me do it. And that's why y'all hear them laughing. But you know, why? You know, why me? Why this morning? You know, why are you so angry? Wow, it's so early, it's so cold. I know you don't want to be outside the car. I don't either. What are we doing? I'm outside my job. I'm looking like a criminal. Right. You know, and I don't like that. I don't like that, right. You know? And so, nonetheless, he ends up pulling off, and I'm thankful that I have my life. I'm thankful that I was able to not get a ticket. No financial issue. Thankful that my license, my registration wasn't actually out of date. So that even if he wanted to give me a ticket, he couldn't have. And so I was just thanking God, but it's hard because as a black man, I'm mad. I'm mad. And this shouldn't have happened to me. Now, there's 100,000 things that are worse that's happening to other people, but why me this morning? But as a Christian, I'm thankful. Like, God, I know you have my back. You just had me pray for this man before he even pulled me over. Right. That's why I ain't got no ticket.
Right.
And so I want to say, well, you couldn't do it because you couldn't have did it, but I know it was God.
Right.
But then I know I'm black.
Right.
I say all that to say this. It can be quite difficult to be both Christian and black,
right,
whether you're getting pulled over or not.
Right.
And this is just not a message for black people. If you're listening to this and you are in the body of Christ, you need to know this. Sometimes it's hard to be Christian and black.
Right.
Sometimes it's hard to have ideals that teach and preach a lot of nonviolence and loving your oppressors and all these things when oppressor for us is not just metaphorical.
Right.
It's not just a metaphor. When we hear slave obey your masters, we're not thinking about no Gentiles and no Romans.
Right.
We're just not.
Right.
We're talking about child slavery here,
right,
with people that look like you against people that look like me.
Right.
And so it's hard. Because we see, and a lot of black people are resistant to this because this was used to do it.
That's right. That's right.
They use this.
Yeah.
This is what they use.
Right.
And so with black people, it's sometimes it's hard to be black and Christian. And if you are black and you're not a Christian, I would understand if that was your reasoning. And so as a black man, I am hurt. And I'm upset. I'm offended. I am confused. I'm perplexed. I'm exhausted. I'm frustrated, irritated, weary, angry, and indignant. But at the same time, I feel a level of unexplainable peace.
Yeah.
And so it's both. It's not this or that. It's this and that.
Yeah.
And sometimes that can be hard to walk. And so I do want to make this very clear, and I want to say this explicitly. As a black man, I believe that black lives matter. I believe racism and police brutality are real and wrong. I believe that those officers should be held accountable for their actions. And I do know that we need legislative change on every political level. I see the need for donating, protesting, voting, speaking up, speaking out, marching, sharing, liking, hashtagging.
Say it now. Come on.
I see the need to highlight and educate others on the systematic oppression that black people face in this country every day, to this day, not just in the past, to this day.
Yeah.
However, as a Christian, should I just be praying? Should if I get up here and I have an opportunity to do this, should I just stick to the gospel?
Yeah.
Don't all lives matter?
Yeah.
I don't,
come on,
what would Jesus do?
Come on, man.
What would he say?
Right.
If he was here today, what would he be on right now?
Woo.
Where would he be at?
Woo.
Would he have posted the black square or not?
Whoa.
Would he have made a statement?
Oh my God.
Church family, regardless of where you stand on any particular issue, white or black, I'm talking to everybody now.
Right.
Our country's in the midst of a battle.
Yeah.
Our communities are in the midst of a battle.
Yeah.
Our families are in the midst of a battle. Therefore, as the church, how do we fight?
Mm-hmm.
I did not say if. If we
yeah.
should. I'm not even going to go there because it's already 12:05. I'm not going to sit here and try to convince them that they should be fighting. Like, I mean, if you need some convincing, there's a lot of red letters. I'm going to flip it for you. These all the red ones, read those. And then you'll know if you should fight. But my question that I want to answer for us at the church is how do we fight today? So I got 5 points, all right? We got 5 points, so let's walk through it, all right? Let's get it. First point, we must bring a unique spiritual perspective to the fight. Now, there's a lot of people out there fighting. The streets are full. Social media is full. The comment sections are full. The DMs are full. Everybody got something to say, and everybody got a platform to say it.
Right.
But as the church, white or black, it is our obligation to bring a unique spiritual perspective to the fight. If we come to the fight the same way everybody else comes to the fight, we're doing a huge disservice to what is going on here. We're doing a disservice to the gospel. We're doing a disservice to the community, to the people. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6 in the Message Bible. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6 in the Message Bible. All right, we're there. The world is unprincipled. It's dog-eat-dog out there. The world doesn't fight fair. This is the Bible, people. I'm telling you, this isn't my words. This is the Bible still. You see it on the screen now. The tools of our trade aren't for marketing or manipulation. Let me go back. I'm sorry. I skipped a line. My bad, Nicole. But we don't live or fight battles that way as Christians. We don't do that. We never have and we never will. The tools of our trade aren't for marketing or manipulation, but they are for demolishing that entire massively corrupt culture. Are y'all hearing this?
Come on now.
Okay, this was this, you know, okay now.
Come on.
Like I said, it's 1207, okay. We use our powerful God tools for smashing warped philosophies, tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God. I gotta stop. It's not just about us, and I know that. Black people have been the object of racism and prejudice and oppression for a long time. But it's not just about us.
Right.
You can't develop hate just for skin color. You can't. You may act it out. You may even think that that's what's going on. And in your mind, that may be what's going on. Mm-hmm. But we're tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God. Racism is hate.
Yes. Right.
So if I'm just fighting racism, I might win, I might lose. Mm-hmm. But I'm talking about hate.
Yes.
Come on now.
Okay. All right. So fitting every loose thought and emotion and impulse into the structure of life shaped by Christ, our tools are ready at hand for clearing the ground of every obstruction and building lives of obedience into maturity. Why is this so important, y'all? Because we have to bring a spiritual perspective to the fight. That is one of the things that we bring as the church. That's one of the differences between a group of believers and just a group of anybody else. I'm not trying to make it say this or that, but this is our unique thing that we're bringing. If it's a potluck, you bring mac and cheese, 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 then I bring my mac and cheese. That's not a party. You bring your mac and cheese, but then you bring your lasagna. You bring some chicken, and then you bring some juice. I'll bring the napkins. You know what I'm saying? Y'all, you know how I do it. And I'm taking it to go play. You know? Okay, but my bad, y'all. It's 12:09. Oh, it's only been 2 minutes. We good. Okay. All right, so let's just, you hear what I'm saying, though?
Yes.
You got to bring a unique perspective,
yes.
Or you're wasting time.
Yes.
Or you're wasting time. You know what I'm saying? So let's just go to point number two. We fight with our true enemy in mind. I touched on a little bit in our last point, but I do have real enemies here on earth. There's no denying that, and so do you. And it's very important that you are aware of them and understand how they operate. It's important to defend yourself. It is important to stand up for yourself. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't, but you have to keep your true enemy in mind, because there's a hierarchy of enemies. There's just a hierarchy there. If you're talking about racism, cool. If I can get rid of hate, then I don't got to worry about racism.
Man,
racism not even in the picture. We're talking about roots. We're talking about pride. We're talking about all the confusion and manipulation. If I can get God to remove the blinders off somebody's eyes, I ain't got to worry about what they see when they look at me. And so we have to fight with our true enemy in mind. Let's go to Ephesians 6, chapter 12. This is my favorite passage of all time. An NLT version. Ephesians 6, verse 12 in the NLT version. We're keeping our true enemy in mind, okay? So it says here that we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies. And to the black unbeliever, I know that we are here in the physical. And this scripture is not saying that we don't have physical enemies. I just want to make that very clear. But we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, just flesh and blood enemies, but against every evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Why is this so significant? Because if you have somebody who's being hateful towards you, the one who's pulling the strings is even worse.
Yes.
You have to keep that in mind.
Yes.
This is, you know, you can fight hand to hand if you want to, but you're bringing a knife to a gunfight every time. Every time, because our true enemies are not flesh and blood enemies. From this passage, it goes on and it gives us spiritual weapons that we can use in times like these. And we're not going to go all the way down into it, but I'm telling you, write it down. Ephesians 6, chapter 12, you can fight. Sword, right here. The one offensive weapon that you have. Everything else is for protection. Protecting your mind, your heart, your stability, your feet, your shield. But you need this sword, so I'm just going to throw that out there. We have to keep our true enemy in mind so we don't become distracted and get confused and caught up in the day-to-day mayhem and complaints and the foolishness that's just going on today. You'll never make progress that way. You'll never make progress that way. All right, let's go to point number three. Point number three is we fight in obedience to Christ's commands. Now, this is where it gets tough. This is where it gets a little dicey, Pastor. We fight in obedience to Christ's commands. Now, like I said in the beginning, it's hard to be Christian and black sometimes. It's hard to be Christian and offended. I'll just say that. You don't even have to be black to be offended. Let me open it up. Let me open the floor up. If you get offended, you know it's hard to be Christian and offended. The two really don't mix. It's hard. Yeah, let me read this passage. I think y'all going to like it. I want to set the stage, though. In this passage, we're talking about where Jesus Christ is about to get arrested. And the reason that this is significant to me is because in this time, the disciples were expecting Jesus to be exalted on earth as a king, as the king of the Israelites. However, now he's changing it up a little bit and saying, well, I'm actually about to get arrested and killed. Y'all will be quick not too long after that, but don't worry about it. You're going to be seated in heavenly places with me. The whole game changes. Okay? And so in preparation for his arrest, he started telling disciples, pray so you don't fall into temptation. He told them, when I sent you out as disciples, I told you not to take money. Don't take your sandals. Don't take anything. And he said, did you have all you needed? They said, yes, we did. He said, well, now I'm telling you, get your money. And if you got, get your sword. If you don't have a sword, sell your shirt to get a sword. He's getting them all riled up. Mm-hmm. All right, hey, look, y'all, I was about to go down. You know I'm Peter. I ain't even going to go there yet. Listen. All right, so we're going to go to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, verse 49 through 51. Luke chapter 22, verse 49 through 51 in the NLT. All right, so like I said, we set the stage. You see Judas coming out about to betray Jesus. And when the other disciples saw what was about to happen, they exclaimed, Lord, should we fight? We brought the swords. I'm going to tell y'all, when I read that, that was so funny to me. Because here's the deal. So when Jesus asked them if they had swords, they was like, we got two swords. He was like, that's enough. So there's 12 of them. They got two swords. Like, that's enough. And so when they see it about to happen, they're like, we got the swords. What you want us to do? You know what you want us to do? You know? And then we go to verse 50. It says, and then one of them struck at the high priest's slave, slashing off his right ear. And if you know who that is, that's Peter. And the reason I love Peter, because he's always about it. Peter represents, he's very transparent. That's the thing about Peter. Peter's very true to himself. And I don't think I'm like Peter. I kind of feel like John, where it's like, I'm going to tell everybody, God, you know God loves me the most, you know, like I'm God's favorite, you know. That's what John did when he writes his gospels. It's like, you know, John, the beloved of Christ. Like, that's probably what I would do. But Peter, I love him, though, because Peter, he's always ready, and he'll try to walk on water, but then he'll drown because he's scared. You know what I'm saying? So he'll pull out the sword and cut off the man's ear, and then we're not going to read it, but a few minutes later, he's like I said last week, I don't know him. I don't even know Jesus. Whereas before, I'll die for you, Jesus. I'll go to jail for you, Jesus. He was like, man, I don't know Jesus, man. Y'all tripping. Like, so, but we read it here. He sliced off the high priest's ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. And he touched the man's ear and healed him.
Yes.
Now, what do you do when God starts blessing the person who's offending you?
Wow.
What do you do when you're fighting against oppression and racism and you keep seeing certain people rise to the top? And you're like, hold on now, I just thought that justice was unquenched and God was about to, you know, you told me to bring my sword and now you healing the person whose ear I just cut off?
Come on.
Now, metaphorically, well, I'm not even going to go there. I'm not even going to go there, y'all. But the thing is, we have to fight in alignment with the commands of Jesus, or we take ourselves out of his will. You can be the object of an unjust act, but when you act outside of Christ's commands, God can't back it no more. And not only will he not back it, he may even comfort the person who you were unjust to. Because I'm going to go back to it. Desmond said it first. You can't mock the justice of God. You can't go out here and be sinning in Jesus' name. It don't work like that. You can't say, well, I'm a Christian and I'm this, and they cut somebody's ear off. And this was the metaphor I'm going to make. I'm going to go ahead and make it. It's not biblical. This is what I think. Peter cut somebody's ear off is the same way when we cut somebody's ears off with our words. When we start talking trash to people and we start sharing stuff that really start tearing people down, and we like these things and we comment on this and we'll slide in somebody's DM with some harshness, you cut off their ear and Jesus is about to heal them because he has a plan. And we don't know his plan. And I don't know why all this stuff is happening to us. And I hate it just as much as you do, but I know that God has a plan. So in the meantime, when things are going on, I'm going to be doing what I got to do, but I'm going to do it within the confines of Christ, or I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. And I love black people. And in my career, I am seeking to tear down instances and strongholds of social justice in the education field. Like, that's what I do. That is my heart's desire. That's what I will do. But I have to do it within the confines of Christ, because I love black people, but I love Jesus. I love Jesus, man. Let's go ahead. Luke 14. And we got to go here, because in comparison to Christ, all this, it can't be Black Lives Matter before Christ. Like I said, I do believe Black Lives Matter. And I'm going to do everything that's within my power, capability, within what I'm allowed to do. I'm going to do it. But I have to do it within the confines of Christ, because Christ is my highest authority. Christ is my highest authority. And so if we look at Luke chapter 14, verses 26 and 27, we go NLT. If you want to be my disciple, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else. Your father and mother, your wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. So you cannot prioritize anything over Christ's commands, or you're out of alignment. And so, well, Corey, you know, like, when it comes to, if somebody's, you know, asking me to do something outside the will of God, well, Corey, why you can't do this? Are you not down? You're not trying to? Listen, man, Christ first. And it's like, so why would Jesus tell us we got to hate our mother and father? He's not saying you have to actually hate them, but in comparison to Christ, nothing else can matter that much. If you have allowed your whiteness or your blackness to overcome your Christian walk, your discipleship, you're wrong. White or black. White or black. Because like I said, I love black people. I love my mama, but Jesus did something for me that mama can't do. My daddy can't do it. Wife, children, if you see the scripture, they can't do it. So in comparison, I hate y'all. I'm with Jesus. I don't care what's over there or what I look like for being over here. Jesus over here. And you can't save my soul. I might die tomorrow. But where I go after that is what's important. And so, like I said, I do believe that Jesus will support our press for justice. But we have to be obedient to his commands. Let's go to point number four, y'all. It's 12:20. I know y'all hungry, y'all. I'm sorry. Here we go. You have to, number four, you have to know your role in the fight. This is really important. I don't know how important it is on the scale of points that I got, but it's really important. If you are being led to protest, then protest. If you're being led to donate, then donate. If you're being led to speak up and speak out, please speak up and speak out. If you're led to get interviewed on CNN and be a voice for a whole group of people, please be interviewed. But if you're not being led to protest, please go back home. If you're not being led to type that status, please don't press post. Stay in your lane, because your lane is important. Because it's important. I'm not saying that, hey, stay in your lane because you're messing stuff up. I'm just saying we need you where we need you. Please bring your mac and cheese. Come on, man. We need that. I don't want the chicken with no sides. I mean, it's cool, but, you know. Come on, man. I brought these napkins up in here. I need you to do your, you know. You know, but the thing is, but when we get in seasons like this, we start ranking responsibility. Because you know, somebody's over here interceding day and night in tears, but because they didn't show up to the protest, you're mad at them.
Come on.
Somebody over here, and they over here protesting, but they ain't paid yet. What's better? What's worse? We need it all. But you need to do your part. And if you're trying to twist somebody's arm to do something that you want to do, stuff not going to get done. So we really need you to know your role, be confident in your role, walk in your role. If it's to pray and quiet and nobody's seeing and people calling you names, do it. If you're out there protesting, people saying you need to go home, you don't need to be doing all that, you a Christian, you just need to be out there. It's maybe we need all of it done. We need all of that done. And if you are going to fight like Christ would, Christ knew his role. That man, like I said, he walked to Jerusalem with his face straight to the cross. And then Peter was like, no, be king over here behind me, Satan. Because I can't do what you're trying to get me to do. I got to do. And if you knew what I was doing, you wouldn't even be asking me to get off this path.
Right.
But you don't know what I'm supposed to be doing.
Come on.
And I don't know what you're supposed to be doing, but you do.
Right.
So do it. And do it proudly. People, you know, man, it's getting crazy out here, y'all. Everybody trying to pick a side. Everybody trying to say, well, did you do this? Did you do that? Did you post this? Did you go here? Did you pray this? Did you give this? Man, I'm doing me.
Come on.
And you need to do you.
That's right.
Because everybody's role is important. Everybody's role. Let's go to our last point, man. We fight as Christians, as believers. What's different, man? What are y'all doing that's different? Because it looks the same from the outside, y'all. You standing right here protesting, I'm standing right here protesting. But here's the difference. We fight on God's timing and with his power. Let's go to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. And we can go NLT. We can go NLT. Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 5. It says, once he was eating with them. Now, this is after the death of Christ. Christ has resurrected. Amen. Praise God for that. And he is revealing himself to the disciples. And at one point, they were sitting and eating. And when they were, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. Y'all, well, let me just keep reading. John baptized with water, but in a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now that you know your role, and once you figure out your role, you have to do it on God's timing and with his power. All right, do it on his timing and in his power. This is very important because if you're operating in what God told you to do without your anointing, you're just doing what everybody else is doing. And I'm not saying there's not a place for that, but you're selling people short.
Yes.
You're selling the kingdom short. You're selling your ministry short. Brother Desmond is mac and cheese. If he just follows the recipe off the internet, then it's just mac and cheese.
Right.
And that's cool. You know, it's mac and cheese.
Right.
But if he used that recipe that his grandma left in the cupboard, with the stuff in there that you don't even, why we got to get this stuff? What you mean?
Right.
Well, this don't go in mac and cheese.
Right.
Put it in there.
Right.
You know how it tastes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, come on now. If you're not going to do that, just go get the blue box. And come on now. But when God's anointing is on something, it's different. Because like I said before, we need to change the laws. We need to change the policies. We need to be out there protesting. But when you're out there protesting, now you can change laws and hearts at the same time. Because this is the danger that I see. I would hate for us to have twisted, because there is an area of America that is evil. We know that. There's a part of it. I love America, but in Jesus' name, I pray that this is the worst place I'll ever live, because after this, I'm going to heaven. All right? So no shade to America, but this is not my home. It's just not. And I can't think about it that way. But while I'm here, if I twist the arm of racist America, not all of America, but just racist America, and I twist their arm to do what I want them to do, as soon as I let their arm go, trust and believe, there will be repercussions. But sometimes that's what you can do with force. There's force in numbers, and we all pull together. We can force people to do what we want them to do. But what happens when we start dissipating? The difference is when you fight with God's power and his anointing and the Holy Spirit, people's hearts can change. Now people's hearts can change. And we have to remember that as much as Christ would like, I believe, so social justice to take place in America, for there to be retribution between white people and black people, between the haves and the have-nots. Christ has a higher mission even than that. And if we can get to that, we don't have to worry about this as much. So as Christians, it is our responsibility to bring our sauce to the table, that secret sauce, which is the anointing, the Holy Spirit. And like Christ said, even once you know what to do, don't do it until you get that anointing, okay? And as Christians, I believe we must get into this fight. However, as we do, we must bring a kingdom perspective. We must keep our true greatest enemy in mind. We fight in obedience to Christ, and we know our individual roles, and we fight on God's timing and in his power. And so to conclude, I want to let you know today that ultimate justice was served on the cross when Jesus Christ sacrificed his life as an atonement for our sins. And though we deserve to die because of our sins, Jesus died so that our sins may be forgiven. And then God rose him from the dead, and he demolished death, he demolished the grave, so that we can be in right standing with God, so we can be justified with God. And when we're justified with God is when we can truly live in peace. And so for the last time today, I'll say, no justice, no peace. And so today you may be sitting there listening and you say, well, hey, I'm down for the cause, but I have not been down for the cause of Jesus Christ. And you're saying, well, hey, I've been down for the cause of Jesus Christ, but from this I recognize I've been fighting, but I've been outside of God's commands. I've been having too much hate in my heart to feel safe, to feel justified, to have peace. And if you don't have any peace, that is a symptom that there's more salvation in store for you. And so what I want to do is I want to open the door for there to be a few decisions to be made today. One is to receive Christ for the first time. You're saying, hey, I want to be on that team. Because I'm going to tell you, spoiler alert, this is the winning team. Regardless of what happens to me here on this earth, I know I'm on a winning team. And I can have peace through that, okay? And you may just want to rededicate your life to Christ. Recognize, man, I got a little too far off track. I'm trying to reel that thing back in. I've been tripping and dipping a little bit more than I should have. You know what I'm saying? And so you find yourself out of alignment with Christ. You know, or you may have dedicated your life to Christ. You want water baptism or potentially become a partner or member with the Bridge Church of Alabama and say, man, I kind of like what y'all talking about. I've been seeing these messages for a few weeks now, and I want to get in on that. Then we want to give you that opportunity. So today, if you want to receive Christ, I want to pray a prayer with you. And more so than just a prayer that is recited, these are steps that it takes to become saved, to be in a process of being saved. And so as I pray, I want you to believe it and receive it in your heart. You don't have to repeat it after me as I repeat it directly. But I'm going to share with you the steps. And if this is your heart's conviction, you'll know what's going on, okay? And so if you'd like to repeat after me, then do. But if not, just let it soak in. Father God, we give you all the praise and the glory. And we thank you for the opportunity to just meet in your presence safely, comfortably. And we just give you all the praise and the glory, God. Thank you for this word today, Lord. Thank you for every ear. Thank you for the worship, for every team, every person who made this service possible, Lord. And we just thank you that the technology is working. And we just thank you. But God, today we know that there are individuals who may have heard this message and they want to come to you. You have already called them and they feel that urging on their heart. And so we want to lead them in that. And so if you're feeling led, just follow along with me. Christ, today I've heard your word. I believe in your word. I believe it to be true. It's piercing my heart. I believe and have faith that you are the Son of God, that you died on the cross for the atonement, the justification of my sin, and then you were raised to life so that I could be in right standing with God. I know that through this I received the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so God, I want to repent of all my sins. If you have sin in mind, If you confess your sin to the Lord and repent from those sins, change your mind, change your heart, turn to the Lord. And then as it says in Romans, you confess Christ to be both your Lord and your Savior. He saved you. He's your Lord. Consider being baptized as you pray, ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you and baptism to you. And then, Lord, I just want to have an ongoing commitment to serve you and to serve your ways, to follow your commands. Lord, I want to fight, but I want to fight your way. And so, Lord, I receive you and I believe you, and I pray and ask all these things in your son's name, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And so if you prayed that prayer and you had a heart change, then we believe that you are saved and there are heavens rejoicing as we rejoice with you. And if you did, please sound off in the comments. Let us know. Not just in the comments per se, but let us know so we can connect with you. Christianity is about community with God and his Trinity, but also with the believers. And so let us know so we can support you. And if you made another decision, let us know so we can walk you through that. And church, I just want to say it's been a blessing to be up here. I know it's, 12, I ain't too mad at 12:32. I'll take that. 12:30 is when I'm just like, all right, I got to get out of here. But at 12:32, I'll take it. So I appreciate y'all listening and tuning in. If you enjoyed this message, share it with somebody else. And as always, I don't just mean click share. Share it with somebody else. Share the tips. Just share the message. This isn't my message. This is our message. This is God's message for us. So just share it with somebody. And if you just want to just post it and share it, then do that. But just share the message and live it out. Let's fight like Christ would want us to, so that we can get victory, y'all. Let's not do all this and not get victory. All right? Let's do that. And so, man, I bless y'all, and I pray that in the name of Jesus that God would just bless every person in this room and every listener, and that, God, you would just continue to work on the hearts of those who are hearing and maybe on the fence. And just I pray that as we go forth this week, we have clarity and vision on how we can fight right, how we can do it the right way. And I just pray all those things in Jesus' name. And just as we leave, just remember that here at the Bridge Church of Alabama, we are loving God, loving people, and pursuing purpose.